welcome you all to this very special PIC event being organized at College of Engineering, Pune.
The subject given to me is winning in the era of turbulence. I would like to deal with this subject, and you would have noticed that I use the word alternative ideas. The first thing I want to say is I don't have any formula. And this term VUCA environment has become famous of late. VUCA, I hope you all know. I mean, otherwise you're considered a Luddite these days if you don't know this jargon. V stands for volatile, U stands for uncertain, C stands for complex, and A stands for ambiguous. So that's the first part of it, what is the VUCA environment? And that I want to argue that human adaptiveness is the key. It's not technology, it's not knowledge, it is human adaptiveness. And then I would like to conclude, and it's, I shouldn't call it a conclusion, the main body of what I want to share with you are key lessons and messages. So those are the three parts that I have to what I want to say. So I would like to point out to you what happens when we are not able to figure out what's happening in VUCA, and yet we are compelled to make statements. Anybody who has been CEO or CFO of a company, or who has been in the government in a senior position to do with economy or exchange, knows that this happens. You really don't know the truth, you really don't know the solution, certainly around 100%. And the TV people will come to you and you feel compelled to say something. And in your attempt to say something profound, you make very pontifications, great pontifications, which of course haunt you in this modern day of media for a long time. So in 2011, I undertook an exercise in the field of management, of course. I did not go into the public space, about what CEOs had said about their companies. And I have been selective, I admit, in extracting what I call management bombast. For example, company number one, going forward, we are focused on aggressively managing the short-term challenges and opportunities, and we remain committed to delivering our mid-decade plan and serving a growing number of customers. Second example, we will accelerate our leadership across five priorities, which of course are mentioned, and we'll compete to win in the core. Everybody's trying to do exactly the same thing. And so on and so forth. Now, the reason I put this chart up is not to poke fun at somebody else, but to point out and make ourselves aware that the more VUCA the environment, the more humble you should become about what's happening. But our response, the brain sort of processes this in some magical ways, is to make very profound statements. We all want this SPCC world, which is the opposite of the VUCA world, which is a simple, predictable, clear and calm world. And we all have this imagery and this dream in our mind that our grandfather's time was SPCC. All our grandfathers must have lived in some village somewhere and gone on bullock carts and so on and so forth. But it is not so. And the fact of the matter is that we are like a molecule which is going around in a spiral and is accelerating to the center. And therefore this, as my physics teacher had taught, all our physics teachers taught us, the rate of change is what is causing the acceleration. So it's the acceleration part of it. It's always been a VUCA. Therefore, if VUCA has been there all the time for 5,000 years, then how have humans adapted to it? So there are two very simple ways one can categorize. One is what I call technical adaptation. The second is called human adaptation. Technical adaptation is possible when you have new tools, new insights. But it's the second one that has attracted my attention, the human adaptiveness. That human response to what happens is retarded by the rate at which the molecules in your brain can rearrange themselves. This attracts a fair amount of attention, but is very difficult to solve because there are no physics and chemistry and biology you can attach to it. In talking of the human adaptiveness, and having explained that that is the focus of what I want to talk about, I will go straight into some lessons and messages. I've looked at nature, I've looked at animals, I've looked at flowers, I've looked at birds. I've looked at things that all of us see every day. And therefore, one of the things I've is to learn from nature. Now, in nature, God has made, I don't know how many species, thousands, millions. There's only one species that expects certainty. Every morning in Serengeti Park, every gazelle gets up and says, how will I last today? And figure out how to run faster than the next gazelle, if not faster than the cheetah or the animal, the predator that's chasing. Why is it that humans are the only ones who expect that life will carry on exactly the same way? The rupee will stay at 45 and, you know, business will... Because that is human nature. Humans yearn for stability. But by trying to make a distinction between our intellectual quest for efficiency and our practical adaptation through effectiveness, and to point out the difference between efficiency and effectiveness. So I put down on a chart here, in efficiency, you're trying to work on things you understand quite well. You plan in detail and review the actions against that plan. You impose a process and a responsibility, project management. You expect completion as per an agreed timetable. You throw resources to accomplish the task. What do you see on the right-hand side? Effectiveness. You work on things you don't quite understand. You find it difficult to plan because the way forward is unclear. You try out approaches. You don't have a grand strategy. And then you adjust your plans as you go along. You expect progress, but you're not terribly sure how and when it will be completed. You generate options continuously, but just don't increase your resources. Now, the truth is not that all engineers and accountants live in the left world and everybody else lives in the right world, but we are going between these two worlds. But what I am saying is, this is the battle that a leader faces, that I'm not terribly sure. I know that I can turn around this company or this economy, but how much should I put out and how firm should I be on what it is I'm doing? This is the dilemma of efficiency versus effectiveness. I want to show you a fly. Now, all of you have seen a fly, so you don't need an explanation of a fly. But have you asked yourself the question why a fly cannot fly in a straight line? Why does a fly always go around in circles? Sometimes like the government departments. Once I tell you the answer, you'll have great sympathy for government departments. Why government departments, even large corporations? Or any large institution. You see, this is something we all know, but the physics of it we don't remember. A fly goes in a helical spiral. And any time from the center of the spiral, if you draw a line, you get an equilateral triangle. Please note that the angles are identical. Does it mean anything? It only confirms that not only does a fly go around in circles, it also confirms that the physics of it is understood by us. And there are lots of studies on this subject. But why does this happen? It is in the construction of the fly's eye. Now, this is the eye of the fly. Please don't think this is some unguided missile coming to hit you. It's magnified several times. Now, you and I have an eye. We have two eyes. And it's called a simple eye. A simple eye means it is complicated. I don't know why they gave it that word. It can move in all directions, up and down, around. And so, if I want to go towards him, Mr. Chaudhary, I can turn my face, I can look at him, I can turn my body, and I walk in a straight line. That's called efficiency. Now, look at the plight of the poor fly. The fly, what you're seeing in the center is the sort of the nose of the fly. And it's got two eyes, which are like two balloons, like this. And that's what you're seeing on both sides. And what you're seeing below are sort of legs and so on and wings. So the fly has got what is called a compound eye. And it's used the word compound eye to mean an aggregation of simple eyes. There are 4,000 lenses in that eye, 2,000 on each side. Each lens is fixed, it cannot move. So a fly cannot do this like a Kathakali artist. There'll be no Kathakali dance from a fly because it can't move its eyes. And the fly can see behind, sideways, front, everywhere. But each image is different. So it cannot get focus. So what the fly sees, sarvajnani, sarvavyapi, it's a very hazy image. And so the only way for the fly to get to a target, if I put a pot of honey here, and assuming it can see it or smell it or whatever, it has to move its body, adjust it again and again, and a bit like in Bombay airport, they keep you waiting in the air, and finally you get a landing right. By moving its whole body, it goes around and it comes and then settles down to the point where it is required to go. So for me, the lesson over here is, it's a characteristic of the VUCA world that there are multiple people, multiple segments with multiple points of view, and the eyes that we have got are a bit operating like the fly's eye. So the fact of the matter is that institutions and organizations have compound eyes, and that is the way we perceive the VUCA environment. It's confusing and it is unclear, and our ability to move is not efficient but effective. And in this academic training and social training we've received in our school and college and our families to be efficient, the needs of the job require you to be effective. You wish efficiency equals effectiveness. They are not equal, and so you're left with a dilemma. So you have a seminar on how to deal with the VUCA world and the whole pedagogy that goes with it. So I said, let's put down and see from whatever I have learned during my career. And the first thing I want to say is to touch upon is what is our reaction when we are confronted with turbulence? What is our reaction? The moment there is turbulence, you're trained to suppress the turbulence. But you look at the way nature deals with it, it seems to be very different. Nature seems to say, you can control turbulence if you want, but maybe you can leverage turbulence. And there are some situations where leveraging works and some where controlling works. So the definition between efficiency and effectiveness, I'm showing through this little, you're going from A to B, the left side is efficiency and the right side is effectiveness. And I'm not saying one is good or one is bad. But I think the ability to have the discrimination, to judge a situation, to know when to use what, becomes very important. I'm going to run through about 15 slides, which are all pictures, which show how sometimes you're trying to suppress turbulence, sometimes you're trying to leverage it. If I give you an internal combustion engine, you're constantly trying not to have the turbulence come up and disturb you in other ways, and to leverage it and use it in other ways. Earthquake-proof housing. A surfer never goes in a straight line for the same reason. He's leveraging the currents rather than trying to suppress the currents. You see how water goes down the sink in your basin, in your bathroom. Never goes in a straight line. It always goes this way. And by the way, here, if you have a little moment for a Vedantic insight, if you look at the speed of the molecules as they are going, and the outer perimeter of this, it is very slow. And as you get to the close to the radius of the spiral, it accelerates. But the center of the spiral is absolutely calm. There is no movement at all. And you see this reflected in a sense in the galaxies. You see this reflected in the way smoke arises. I want to talk about, I said this human adaptation is controlled by the molecules here and what's in our brain and not by the tools that we have. It is a bit right brain rather than left brain. And I just want to illustrate it with a few slides and then close for a little discussion. The truth of the matter is, human beings behave irrationally but pretend to be rational. And we are the only such species. So why do we apply economic logic to figuring out why the Reserve Bank governor changed the CRR yesterday or the interest rate moved by 100 basis points? Because there's a lot of intuition in this. And I just want to say that the more VUCA it is, the more you have to realize that intuition is also positive. It's not always negative. It is not a solution, but it's an added weapon. See the most important decisions you took in your life. Did you use rationality or intuition? Who you will marry? And I just want to say this, that you have to have a mental model of how your mind works, which is inaccurate for a neuroscientist's point of view, but acceptable for common people.
And I have developed such a mental model. That's your brain. You recognize the thing on the left, you don't recognize what's on the right. The weight of your brain is hardly 3% of your body weight. But it consumes 25% of the energy that you use. You know, this brain is very difficult to understand because even neuroscientists don't understand it. But I want to draw your attention to the three vegetables on the right. There is an okra, bhindi. Then there's an agglomeration, what in automobile language you'll call an aggregates, of 21, 20, 19, etc., which is a lemon, nimbu. And then on top of that, there's a cabbage, which is the top part. But each of these three has a particular role. Even a lizard has an okra. Because in the okra is where the life science, the life human systems operate. So if I raise my hand to hit you and you do that, it is your okra that's done the job. Now mammals have a nimbu. Now in this nimbu is the first time it can express a simple emotion. And a simple emotion means it can show that I love you or I hate you or I'm scared of you or I want to be with you. But then neither lizards nor dogs have a cabbage. That is a unique property that human beings have, Homo sapiens. And what happens in the cabbage is it can give the seat of rationality and it can also give a complex emotion, which means I don't like you, but I give the impression I like you. The brain's remote implicit memory. In that, all sorts of experiences go and sit. So this brim is a very important part of intuition. And I want to emphasize before I close out from this discussion that I am not advocating intuition as a substitute for rationality, but as the last weapon that you have when you finished using all your rationality. I think this is where I'm going to stop. I'm going to skip all the other slides because I think I've got the core of my message across, that VUCA is not new. It is the perception of VUCA that is new, and that we have to revisit some of our assumptions about VUCA and the changing world, and not through the technological adaptations that are increasingly available, but through the human adaptations, which are retarded by inbuilt attitudes in our mind, that going around in circles, looking for effectiveness rather than efficiency is not a bad thing. In the more complex the situation, the more likely it is to be the solution. And that don't suspend your rationality, don't substitute it, but do think of how you can improve your intuition. It'll help a lot. Thank you very much.